Lately, I've been obsessed with Bach's Goldberg Variations. There are 30 variations based on this aria. I've known and studied this for decades. I've taught it from a compositional point of view, looking at each individual variation and its compositional structures. But what I'm obsessed about now is the transitions. And what I can learn from that, and hopefully, it'll be of some use to you. So this is the first published edition, 1741, of the aria from the Goldberg Variations. First, I'd like to listen to a modern version on piano by Glenn Gould that he did in 1955. We'll look at the modern transcription. Then we'll do a quick listen to the same section by Gustav Leonhardt on harpsichord, and then finally we'll go back to the Gould and modern transcription to look at the transitions. What I'm going to do is take the last two bars of each piece and the first two bars of the next, and see what's going on there. So, I hope you enjoy the ride. I'm going to geek out along the way. Because, as many of you know, from the late 60s to the early 80s, I was doing nothing but early music, concertizing on recorder and baroque trumpet both here and in Europe, and directing the early music ensemble at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. Fasten your seat belts, sit back and relax, and I hope you enjoy my deep dive into the transitions on the Goldberg Variations. So first off, here's Glenn Gould, and then it'll go into Gustav Leonhardt on harpsichord, and then we'll come back to the piano to explore the transitions. First, let's look at the aria itself. It's a sarabande. A sarabande was a Renaissance and Baroque dance piece, and it messes with the natural accents of a 3-4 bar. Your normal accent pattern in 3-4 is strong, weak, weak, strong, weak, weak. If you put that in poetic meter, it's a dactyl, stressed, unstressed, unstressed, stressed, unstressed, unstressed. It's basically a waltz, you know, ba da bum, or dee da da, dee da da. The sarabande is much slower than a waltz, and it puts the stress on beat two. So we have, instead of dee da da, we have da, dee da da, dee. And the actual dance, the partners dip on beat two. So beat one is sort of a releve and coming up, and beat two, you really feel that accent. So this is a sarabande, as you can see the opening line, and beat two gets the stress. As it does in the second bar and the third bar, and you'll notice these little squigglies. Ornaments actually emphasize, strengthen what might be a weak beat. So you can really see it here in bar three. And you can see bar four, everything ends on beat two. The other thing that Bach's doing here is messing with, by putting an ornament, this is called a mordent. It goes ba-da-lam, just like the opening of the Toccata and Fugue in D minor. Ba-da-lam, ba-da-lam, boom. But by ornamenting beat three, it makes it a strong beat as well. So he's right out of the gate messing with us and messing with the physics and the tradition of the sarabande. The other important compositional point is it's a ground bass, a repeated bass line that you can see here. It's a rather famous one. And this goes throughout. There are some variations, but it's present most of the time. And if it's not there, its harmonies are. The other thing to note is there are no dynamic markings or tempo markings throughout the entire set. So that's going to play an important role as we listen to different interpretations or discuss different interpretations. Okay, let's look at the transition between the last two bars of the aria and the first two bars of the first variation. What can we learn from this transition? Well, of course, there's this tempo shift, or apparent tempo shift. The end of the aria is slow, and variation one is fast. So transitionally, this is what we would call a jump shift. However, the last two notes of the aria are the same two notes of variation one, the low G in the bass clef and the G in the treble clef. So that's sort of the continuity that gives this jump shift some cohesion. Also, it was a choice to end the aria, which was slow, softly, and to start variation one forte, loud. And as we saw, Bach was playing with different stress and accent patterns in the aria. And I mentioned that mordent, the ba-da-lam, sometimes he writes it out. And as we can see here in the top line, this is a written out mordent. So he's accenting beat one here. If we just look at the top line, it is clearly in 3-4, da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and it keeps leading to the one. So it's almost a, you know, a fast waltz, da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's clearly in 3-4. But the bass line is, for my money, clearly in 6-8. And look, he puts a mordent going to beat two. So he's still accenting beat one and two. And look, this is like, this can be 6-8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. A big Renaissance and Baroque device known as hemiola, having one part in 3-4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's 2 against 3, that's hemiola. So part of this jump shift is we're going from what we might call something more normal in the end of the aria as far as meter, and then we jump into this hemiola, 2 against 3. So it's just amazing. So let's hear that again, and then we'll move on to the end of this variation.
just a little footnote for clarification on that hemiola, two against three. So if you have 6/8 notes in 3/4, the accents, of course, are in 1, 2, and 3. And in 6/8, there's two accents, one on 1 and 1 on 4. So we have 2 and 3. The classic version of that is. So this transition is also about going from simple meter to complex. So that transition again. Okay. And how does this all apply to electronic music? Because I know many of you probably only know me for that. But you can send these to different VCAs, right? And of course, with longer sequencers, many more stages, you can do very complex rhythms. These can go to three individual VCAs. These can re-trigger LFOs or envelope generators. You can also, what I've been doing lately is taking outs and stacking them together and putting that into a single VCA or pinion filter. And then same with these two. Okay, onward.
Let's give a listen to the end of variation one into the top of variation two. Okay, before we dive into this transition, I just want to point out that in the original aria, Bach always ends on beat 3. One would think you would end on the 1 of the last measure. That's sort of standard operating procedures. So again, he's messing with us. Here's the aria. And here's the last bar, and it does come to a cadence, but then he adds all this stuff that drives towards that last beat. And in all cases, all of not only the aria, but all the variations end on beat 3, which is theoretically the weakest beat. But what that buys him and buys us as a listener is it makes you want to have more, even though it's a full cadence, it leaves you wanting to hear what's next. This is in contrast to, okay, Bach was 1741, 8 years earlier, Handel wrote a very famous Sarabande, also based on a ground bass. You'll notice that he ends definitely on beat 1 and in a way just going down to the low D on beat 2 reinforces the 1, and beat 3 is completely empty. Let's take a listen. Some of you will recognize this from, it was orchestrated for Barry Lyndon, the movie by Stanley Kubrick. Okay, and let's skip to the end so you can hear that strong ending on the final measure. Full stop. Game over. Actually, Handel does go on to do a few variations, but they're sort of predictable, and it comes out being more boxy to my ear because everything always ends full stop. Back to our transition. What I learned here is, you know, you'll recall variation one is all this hemiola. It's 2 against 3, and it's really, really busy. And what I found fascinating was he ends on a unison. This G and this G are actually the same note. They're played with one finger. So after all that complexity, he ends on the weakest beat and just a single note, which then leads into something more, it's the simplest ending possible, one finger, into the simplest duple meter possible. So things go from complexity to simplicity. And this is also the first time he introduces a B natural. Everything else has ended on G to this point, be they in octaves or unisons. So he introduces the third, which opens up this immediately. And you'll notice that even this is in a 2-4 bar, if you recall, the sarabande always accents beat two. And so here he's carrying that on with accenting beat two, the weak beat of a 2-4 bar, with again the mordant and actually giving it some length. And this continues throughout that variation. What the takeaway for me is he is thinking about the endings as much, if not more, about the beginnings. I think when we or I think of transitions, I'm always going like, what do I do next? I'm trying to figure out what's next, rather than spending a lot of time figuring out what did I just do, analyzing how I ended something or strategizing how I might end something. So be it electronic music, composing, or performing, I think paying attention to endings is my takeaway. Also, okay, now we're going to geek out. I did a little format here of the endings and beginning notes, and also the meters of the Goldbergs. So here's the aria. And I just find this fascinating. You don't have to read music, just the graphics, I think, speak for themselves. Aria ends on a G and a G. Variation one begins on the same G and G. Variation one, that was the really complex one, ends on a single note. And it's a G different than these Gs. And then we move to the second and we add the B. So this movement from simplicity to it's a simple meter, but we're getting harmonically more interest. And it ends on a low G and a rest in the top. So he keeps changing it up. And then we move into 12-8, and again, have that B and a different G. And we finally end, this is the first time we end again on the third beat, but the end of three is actually a full chord there. And then four begins with a G in the bass clef and a rest. So I'll continue this little outline as we go because I'm fascinated to see what happens next. Okay, so let's take a listen again to the transition between end of variation one and into variation two. Thanks for listening, and we'll move on. Let's now listen to the end of two going into three. Okay, there's so much going on here. Again, two was relatively simple in duple time. And now we're going into 12:8, and it's much more complex. So if you remember, 1 was quite complex accent-wise and meter-wise, 2 more simple, 3 more complex in many respects, which we'll look at in a moment. But my takeaway here as I'm starting to look at this is the big concept for transitions is what is consistent and what is contrasting. And in the Goldberg variations, what's consistent is it's all in the key of G. G major for the most part, it does go into G minor, but you know, you could put a Schrute box or an easel drone of G or G and even D for the whole piece and hear what that sounds like. It would all work harmonically and rhythmically, of course. So the consistency that Bach is working with is the key of G. And as we've seen, everything ends and begins on G. You could extrapolate this to, abstract electronic music that I do, or techno or ambient, or let's even open it up broader as a composer or a live performer, analyze what is consistent in your vocabulary and then how, what your possible tools of contrast are. I'll let you figure that out. Here, what we have with Bach is, again, we end on a single note with a rest in the right hand and a low G in the left hand. And then, boom, everything shifts into 12:8, which, again, we can have a couple different accent patterns going on. The top line phrase is going from, is driving to, that's beat 1, and it's driving to beat 3, 1, and 3. The bottom line really feels like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's almost a little waltz down here. So we've got that metrical complexity, and he ups the ante even one more by making this a canon, like in Row, Row, Row Your Boat, right? Here's the row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. And then this is where the next row, row your boat would come in. And as you can see, this B and this B is tied over, and it's the exact same phrase. So this is what we call a canon at the unison. And here's another way of contrasting. And Bach, every third variation, does another canon, but at a different interval. Instead of starting on the same interval for variation 6, he does a canon at the major second. So when row, row, row your boat comes in the second time, it comes up a whole step, and that canon works itself out. So what's consistent? What's contrasting? Okay, let's take a listen again to Variation 3. And now what's going to happen in Variation 4? Before we look at the Variation 4 transition, two things. One is, I think I'm going to go as far as the beginning of variation 6, and then I'll probably call it a day for now, but this should give us enough things to have looked at. And secondly, earlier I mentioned, the concepts of consistency and contrast and said I'd leave that up to you. Well, yeah, but I'd be happy to, give you some of my thoughts on that. If the consistency is a drone or a key, then options for contrast are rhythmic variation, accentual variation, density versus sparsity, timbral shifts for sure, and also dynamics, loud, soft, or even silence. if the consistency is a steady rhythm, be it any sort of techno, dance, electronic, beat-driven music, then options are, again, timbral, and of course, maybe something sustained or contrasting as far as shape of either melody or other sound effect elements, and accent beats, mixing that up. Okay, let's take a look at going into variation 4. So again, we've gone from really complex rhythmic structure, the 12-8 that was in variation 3, into, again, a strong, simple 3-8 and sparse compared to the density of the variation before. Also, you'll notice that at the end of variation 3, he actually ends on a chord for the first time. The G, B, and G, and then starts the next one off with just a single note. Okay, let's take a listen to that again, and then we'll move on. Thanks for hanging in with me this long. Okay, probably only another 5 or 10 minutes at the most. Now, the end of 4 and into 5. Okay, interesting thing here is this is the first time he does not end on beat 3. The end of 4 has a rest, and he solidly ends on beat 2. I'm finding he's always working the metrical accents, and I think that is one thing that definitely keeps my interest, even if it's on a subliminal level. So yeah, ends on beat 2, no beat 3, and then in 5, you know, we've gone from, again, something simple, more simple in 4 to something more complex in 5. And also, by having these sort of staccato eighth notes in the bass and a quarter note on beat 3, he's emphasizing beat 3. So again, this sort of forward motion, and of course, all the 16th notes up here are playing right along. So again, continuity and contrast. We're just going to do one more. We're going to go from 5 into 6, and then I'll wrap up with some final observations. So let's listen to this one again. Okay. Now the end of 5 and into 6. Okay, instead of opting for this sort of balance of complexity to simplicity and back and forth, this is clearly ending a complex variation and just really upping the ante, going from 5 to 6. He does end 5 on beat 3 here, and he goes from 3-4. We're there into 3-8, and this is variation 6. And as I mentioned earlier, starting with 3, every 3 variations he does a canon. So the complexity went up here because there's a canon at the second. The first voice comes in here on a G, and then immediately the that's sequenced up a step, starting on an A, and they just chase each other throughout the whole variation. So what are my takeaways from all of this? I think continuity and contrast. And I think as electronic musicians, as composers, as live performers, as improvisers, that's something to keep in mind. Look at what can be continuity and how we can contrast that. Bach, clearly, his continuity is we're in the key of G, and he has a repeated bass line or set of harmonies that he is, working with. And the way to up the ante for him and to really play with it seems like putting these in different meters and just exploring different accent patterns within those different meters. Once again, let's take a look at the, this is going to be a jump in. Yeah, there's sort of my little endings and beginning notes of the first six variations. And as you can see, the first two, the aria and the first variation, are in 3-4. And then he moves to duple meters, 2-4 and 12-8. Then back to 3-8, 3-4, and 3-8. And, see if I can make this transition. Where'd it go? The variation 7 is in 6-8, 8 is in 3-4, 9 is in common time or 4-4, 10 is in cut time or 2-4, variation 11 is in 12-16, and then we're finally back to 3-4 with variation 12. So you can see he's giving himself lots of playroom for, again, different possibly different tempi, but definitely different messing with meter. And this can surely be used, I would think, in electronic music that is beat-driven. It can be used in ambient music as far as, even though it's the time scale might be much longer as to what's happening. And time scales. That's another fascinating thing. As we looked at with the hemiola, he can have time scale of 3 juxtaposed with the time scale or a beat accent scale of 2. And this actually ends up reminding me a lot of my favorite book, Composing Electronic Music by Curtis Rhodes. And in the chapter on composition, he talks about the importance of integrating and juxtaposing and playing off of different time scales in a piece of music. Albeit it's more abstract in our electronic music these days, but I think Bach was really playing with that. And I'm going to see if I can't do this on screen as we talk, or as I talk. What I find fascinating is, I know this is maybe seemingly inconsequential, but the beginning note of the aria are these two G's, and it ends an octave lower G's. And so we've seen he always ends on G, sort of has to, but he never ends the same way twice. Even that G, there's a B against it. And this G here is There's a two octave spread. So let me just draw these in to see what's going on here. This then comes down and this goes up. What I'm sensing is continuity and contrast and a sort of breathing, if you will. Things expand and stay the same and contract, disappear. So those, and now if I go in here and do this, if I just take that out and see what's going on, I think it makes my point about this expansion and contraction. I know these are the beginning and end points, but those are all the transitions. So I guess my takeaway is expanding and contracting is like breathing. And so what I learned here is he is making the large structure breathe. And even if we go into the smaller structures, you can see how it is breathing. And this expansion and contraction, continuity and contrast is definitely something I think about doing free improvisation with electronic music. I often do not know where I'm starting because I have a patch that when I touch the touch plate, I have no clue what the sound is. I just need to follow that sound, and that begins the evening of improvisation. And I will follow that, listen to it, expand it, develop it. And all the time I might find that it's gone from something simple to something very complex, and that I will also be sort of analyzing in the back of my mind, it's high and mid-range, it's complex, what's missing, something low. So maybe I'll sneak something in low, slowly take away the mid-range, leaving the high, which is sort of the continuity, and then start maybe working the bass or the low stuff into a rhythm. That's assuming like maybe the previous stuff was more sustained or just so dense you couldn't sense the rhythm. So it's always, for me, expanding, contracting. And I know I've gone down this Bach route, but hopefully you find it of interest and of use. Thanks for hanging in there with me, and I'll leave a bunch of links in the descriptions for the sheet music, some Bach performances, Curtis's book, other things I've touched on throughout. Okay, happy transitions.